I've known John since 1970. When he came here, I joined the department as a young faculty member. Cecil Hall, an expert electron microscopist, had just retired, and the department wanted to hire an expert electron microscopist, but would also establish his own research program. So John, who had done beautiful work with Bill Wood on the T4 tail morphogenesis using genetics and electron microscopy, was the perfect candidate for the position and was hired. And since coming here, John has not only ran the electron microscopy facilities for several years, but he also has really had a really highly successful career program, lasting more than 45 years, and is still going. Right, so, in fact, I was reading some of John's papers for this little thing that I'm going to say, and I came across his grant number, NIH grant number, GM grant number, and that tells you how long he's had that grant, all right? And from that, I conclude that he must have had the grant since continuously, since he came here. And that, in this day and age, is an amazing record. So, on research, you know, John has really, whatever he's done, he's put his stamp on it. He has, starting with phase P22 assembly, John moved on to protein structure, protein folding, structure of lens crystallines, and more recently on cyanophages, the cyanophages being the phages that infect bacteria in the oceans. And so this is a really broad swath of biology here. And so for me, you know, whenever I have a question on phages or protein structure or protein folding, John has always been the first go-to person for me. And in fact, just last year, I was writing a paper on nonsense suppression in archaea, and I approached John, and John gave me a couple of key references on the classical literature on the use of nonsense mutants of T4 in the study of phage morphogenesis. So that was really helpful, John. Yeah. Now, in addition to his many scientific accomplishments, John is also well known for his intense devotion to causes that are both, you know, inside and outside of academia. And I would say that John is really truly an activist. If he believes in a certain cause, and he believes in many that are worthy, that he will be front and center and rallying for the cause. And by doing so, John has impressed, you know, me and many others with the sincerity of his beliefs. And really, just to give an example of that, of how he has influenced many through the sincerity of his beliefs and actions, is let me tell you a story, a personal story. Yeah? A couple of months ago, I took a few days off during spring break to go to Scottsdale, Arizona to visit family. Now, in the Scottsdale, even then, in the middle of the afternoon, it's warm, so I would go for early morning walks. And you know, I just to avoid the traffic, I walk along residential areas, and I walk past beautiful homes, mansions with lush gardens and lovely, you know, lawns, and that was very nice. And then one morning, I took a slightly different, you know, route, just a couple of blocks beyond, and again, you know, many beautiful homes and all that, until I got to a street corner. So that saw something that caught my attention. And that was a small church, which almost did not seem to fit into that area. You know, it's a small church, nothing fancy, and around it were huge homes. And I was trying to, I was stood around the corner and trying to take it all in. Something that caught my attention was a banner in front of the church, in front of the church. And the banner said, "Fight for the powerless." And as I read those words, the first person I thought of was, guess who? John. So John, you know, I think I could almost imagine seeing John behind the banner. So John, in many ways, you know, through your leadership, through your actions, and your sincerity of your efforts, you've really influenced me and many others in ways you've probably not imagined nor thought of. So thank you. John, and I hope I'm not taking too much of your time. I know you said you want it all the time, so.
Well, thank you, Tom, for kind words, and for the rest of you taking time out of your, you know, right in the middle of the workday. I should say I resisted Mandana's invitation to give this talk for years and years. I could not imagine having the psychological discipline to summarize 50 years of research in 50 minutes. But in fact, just to identify and credit the more than 40 people involved would take, you know, take all the time. But Mandana prevailed. However, the title is False Advertising, A Conversation. I may work on a whole lot of different things, but my style is 18th century formal lecture, and I don't give any other type of presentation, no matter what the content is. So I'm going to start early in my career at age 3, when I got polio affecting the nerves and muscles in my knee. I recovered, but I was kind of impaired from some years thereafter. And when other kids were outside playing ball, I was inside reading, and I was playing with Lincoln Logs and building Erecta sets and model airplanes. My thesis work at Caltech on phage assembly was the absolute psychological, emotional continuation of that interest in, you know, building model airplanes and watching buildings being constructed. Interestingly enough, that research was supported by the March of Dimes, which was the national response to the polio epidemics, which were quite scary. You know, some of you may have seen pictures of kids in iron lungs. It was, you know, quite dreadful at the time. Anyway, my high school biology teacher, Miss Markin, taught us about the dynamic phloem and xylem that were in the maple trees in front of our house. I was astonished that this dead, this you know, brown thing that never moved had all this stuff going on. I kind of got interested in biology. And then at Yale, I was came under the kind of guidance of Ernest C. Pollard. He was a particle physicist who had been a student of Rutherford at Cambridge, and he was very charismatic. One of the founders of the Biophysical Society. But unfortunately, Yale's biophysics program was only a graduate program. They didn't have any undergraduate courses. So I majored in what seemed to be related zoology. It's what you would have called a classical, absolute classical zoology program. In my sophomore summer, I was lucky enough to get what we would now call a Europe position, a summer internship. Going out on freshwater lakes in a rowboat, taking water samples, bringing them back to the lab, and doing conventional kind of ecological water chemistry, dissolved CO2 and oxygen. And I got paid for it. And I was astonished to learn, nobody in my family knew anybody who made a living that way, that, oh, you could make a living as a scientist. And I also learned that there was such a thing as fellowships to graduate school, which my parents were absolutely resistant to believe that anybody would pay me to go to graduate school. And that happens now in families who are not experienced in the academic arena. They don't believe that kids get paid to go to graduate school. I applied to Caltech for graduate work in part because they had two members of the faculty who were, to me, well-known marine biologists. At the time, I hadn't studied Latin. I didn't know what the word emeritus meant. And then also at Yale, where I was a little bit of an outcast, kind of a poor kid from Brooklyn, I was there on a football scholarship, but I didn't play football because I knew you couldn't make a living doing that. But I had a buddy, Al Capula, also from Brooklyn. He said, Caltech's a place to go. And then there was another guy there, a postdoctoral fellow, Harris Bernstein, who said, if you do go to Caltech, there's this very cool guy, Bob Edgar. So I got out to Caltech. There were no marine biologists. The two famous ones were long retired, hadn't been seen on the campus in 10 years. I note that MIT does that now. They show people in the catalog as emeritus who haven't, you know, long disappeared. Edgar told me, he said, I'm going to figure out kind of the molecular mechanism of morphogenesis and development. And I thought, oh, that's very cool. It's kind of right up my alley how things get built. And I went to work with him. He was a part of the historic phage group. He was Max Delbruck's protege. Max was the head of the group, it was a little European style, Max, and then Bob Edgar, and then us graduate students. And the phage community, you know, it was Caltech, Geneva, Cold Spring Harbor, a few other places. And every summer, people gathered there for the Cold Spring Harbor phage meeting. There's Delbrück, that's our own Salvador Luria. There's Hershey, that's Jim Watson, Frank Stahl. I was in the back washing pipettes for the phage for the phage course. But it was a very, you know, it was a very exciting time. It was kind of the golden age of molecular biology. I was very lucky to come along at the right time. Now, Caltech at that time was a powerhouse in genetics. Alfred H. Sturtevant was there actively teaching. E.B. Lewis was there actively teaching. Norman Horowitz, who was a leading neurospora geneticist, and George Beadle, who had gotten the Nobel Prize for one gene, one enzyme. His influence was still there. So it was very strong in genetics, and my PhD was in genetics. It's actually kind of classical genetics. Lewis had already discovered these bithorax mutants, which gave promise and some profound insight into development. But if you think about a genetics textbook at the time, all the mutants were auxiliary things, eye color in Drosophila. Nobody had mutants of myosin, actin, tubulin, collagen. That was what I was interested in. I was interested in structure, and there weren't any genetics of that. But the Edgar and Epstein in characterizing the TS and AMBA mutants of T4, initially in Geneva with Edward Kellenberger, had found evidence that a lot of these genes affected steps in particle assembly, because if the genes were defective, you didn't get assembled particles. So it looked like these genes controlled structural proteins, which was very exciting. So Caltech had a very good modern, at that time, electron microscopy facility, but as is often the case, nobody using it. Because of my biophysical training, I didn't have any problem picking that up. And there was a postdoctoral fellow there, Michael Moody from Cambridge, England, who taught me microscopy. And I learned to examine these T4 lysates. This was very dramatic. I mean, you go in there often at night, you know, it was cool and quiet. And you look at these samples, which had mutants nobody had looked at before, and you'd see these quite dramatic structures. Here's a picture from the time. So that's the base plate of T4. This is from cells infected with a mutant that doesn't have the tail tube protein. So the base plates accumulate and the cells fill up with these structures, and you get lovely images. Years later, when I was coming to MIT to interview for the job, Harvey Lodish had invited me. And Harvey said, "John, we got plenty of microbial geneticists in this department. What we're missing is a microscopist. Show lots of electron micrographs." This is one of the micrographs I showed. Now, the other thing at Caltech, Linus Pauling was in the chemistry department, the preeminent biochemist, US biochemist of the generation. And he had a certain influence, even though he was politically, it was a right-wing department, and he was a leader of the left wing. Nonetheless, he had scientific influence there. And the chemistry department had Jerry Vinograd and Norman Davidson, names not known to you, but the people who developed ultracentrifugation of macromolecules. And again, because I had this biophysics background, I worked with them and I learned ultracentrifugation, swinging bucket, the early swinging bucket. Well, these are later swinging bucket rotors. We had one of the first ones. All of the work I've done all my scientific life, which always involved things that were big, you know, big proteins, big structures, the ability to do ultracentrifugation was very important. So my actual thesis was on how the tail fibers of phage T4 were assembled. And it turned out it was a way, way more complex pathway than anybody dreamed of. Most people thought, oh, there was just some big protein and some big myosin-like thing and it had a kink in the middle. But no, it turned out there were half a dozen genes. One gene coded a very large polypeptide chain that assembled into one half of the mature tail fiber. The other gene coded for another very big polypeptide chain that assembled into the other half. But four small proteins had to act on these fibers in order to make, all at the tip, to make a junction that'll allow them to bind together to make the mature tail fiber. And it turned out that people just assumed that once these things were formed, they just stuck to the base plate. And then Bill Wood showed that no, the phage makes an enzyme that catalyzes this non-covalent bond. To this day, 40 years later, nobody knows any more than that. Now, I was able to get a Jane Coffin Childs Fellowship coming out of Caltech that allowed me to continue postdoctoral studies. The first year I went to Purdue in West Lafayette, Indiana, important part of my education. I grew up in Brooklyn, never was west of the Hudson River until I actually went out to graduate school, and then I missed everything in the middle. And Purdue was the home of Benzer and Champ, who had done this brilliant work on the use of R2 mutants and T4 to show kind of one gene, what a gene was, cistrons. And I worked with Sewell Champ and learned how to use radioactive amino acids to label proteins. And then continued across the ocean to the MRC to work with Aaron Klug, now Aaron Klug, Nobel Prize winner for his work on electron microscopy and structure determination of viruses. And I was going to do that. That was the beginning of the development of image processing, the use of computers to get more information out of these complex EM images, and it seemed to me the way to go. And Aaron had a senior postdoctoral fellow, David DeRosier, longtime faculty member at Brandeis, great guy. And I came under the tutelage of David, and David said, John, here, and he gave me this book, it said Bessel Functions, or it might have even said Introduction to Bessel Functions, I'm not sure. He said, you know, master this math, and then when you have it down, you know, then we'll get started on the image processing. So I went back to my desk with this Bessel function book, and I slogged through it for 3 or 4 days. At some point, and I went down. So the MRC was the home of Perutz and Kendrew and Watson and Crick and Sanger and Huxley. And of course, they had a very good phage kitchen because of the work that had been done there in the use of T4 mutants to establish the triplet nature of the genetic code. So I went down to the phage kitchen, and I ordered broth and petri dishes and agar, all the stuff I know how to do. And I went back to titering the phage stocks I had brought from Caltech and went back to work on that. I produced samples that were used in the image processing, but I actually never mastered Bessel functions, though I appreciate their value. Years later, DeRosier and I ran against each other for president of the Biophysical Society. And he was very gracious. He did not bring forward my deficiency on the Bessel function front, which would have destroyed my candidacy. And I ended up winning and became the president. Afterwards, he told me he regretted. He should have let people know about that. Oh, that's funny. Right behind me in the MRC was Uli Lemley. Uli Lemley was also working on phage morphogenesis. He was doing the same kind of experiments I had been doing with using conditional lethal mutants. He was interested in head assembly. And all of us structural virologists, not just the phage people, Jake Mazel was there studying poliovirus and wart virus. All the virologists were enormously frustrated. They knew from the electron micrographs that these viruses were made of a limited number of proteins. They could get a tube full of the viruses, but they couldn't get the isolated proteins because they weren't soluble under conditions that people then use for doing protein biochemistry. You couldn't do ammonium sulfate precipitation. You couldn't run it through a column. So Lemley, with his Swiss education, understood the electrochemistry of acrylamide gel electrophoresis. He's the only person I ever met other than the two originators of it from Mount Sinai School of Medicine who really understood what went on when you ran a gel, and he also understood detergent chemistry. And I realized he knows what's going on here. And he said about developing this technique where you'd be able to separate these structural proteins, and I kind of worked as his technician, just doing whatever he said to do. And in fact, the paper, we wrote the first paper which actually described how you actually set up and run these jails is still my most cited paper among 300. So that was very valuable. And then together we were able to identify, we knew by that point that there were about 20 genes needed to build the phage tail, and we were able to identify all the 20 proteins encoded for by those genes. So I then moved, I got the job at MIT, moved to, they liked the pictures. Well, it's funny. I do believe that if I hadn't been, they wanted someone to run the EM facility. They were really totally uninterested in having an electron microscopist. And I do believe it wasn't that I also was a licensed microbial geneticist that I wouldn't have gotten the job, because I was able to talk to all the core people there and relate to them. Anyway, I came to MIT and went to work on this tail assembly pathway. So this is all the steps in genetically controlled steps. It's a little vague here. This is building the arm of the base plate, and then these arms polymerize around a central core. And then once you have the assembled hexagon, the tube subunits polymerize on that, and the sheath subunits polymerize on a tube, and then you put a little cap on there that allows the binding to the head. So this is kind of dramatic, but it doesn't capture what's really going on. If you infect the cells with a mutant, for example, in this very first protein, the gene 10 product, all the downstream proteins are translated, and they sit soluble in the cytoplasm. So the tube subunits don't polymerize into tubes, and the sheath subunits don't polymerize into tubes. Every protein gets activated by being bound to the prior structure. There's no prior structure, everything. So there's no temporal control, no turning on and off of genes, because which some people didn't like, right? Because the only way they wanted to think about development is turning on and off of genes. No, no, all these genes are turned on. The control is all at the level of assembly. We never got this. So what's actually going on, which I'll show you in the next slide. This is the sheath. The sheath polypeptide chains come off the ribosomes. They fold up. And that conformation does not bind to its partners, just sits there in solution. A set of them get bound by this base plate, and that changes their conformation so that they recognize the unreactive conformation of the solution subunits. They bind, they get activated only at the growing tip. The only place this conformational change happens is the growing tip. And now these subunits bind the next one, and the process propagates. And that's how many, 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 many polymerization processes operate. But we never were able to establish this to this day, because most of these proteins were never crystallized. You know, they're hard to crystallize. You get them in high concentration, they assemble, they polymerize, and you don't get crystals. And absent, you know, absent having a conformation that's unreactive and a reactive conformation, it's very hard to convince a modern structural biologist that this is what's going on. And the textbook image, which I helped draw, killed it. So you have this great cartoon, which completely obscures the actual underlying mechanism, right? And you think, I remember when my own son was looking at this picture in his AP biology class. And I could just see that, you know, it was cool, you know, one thing went after another. But you know, you couldn't get out of it what was really going on. So that's actually lost. It's unfortunately, it's going to have to be rediscovered, reinvented in some other systems. Now, at the MRC, you know, I was also obviously involved in the efforts to determine virus structure. Here is Donald Casper's hand-drawn image of an icosahedral shell where all the subunits are the same, but there's different classes of contacts, you know, here's pinky to pinky, here's big finger to big finger, ring finger to ring finger, et cetera. And the physicists loved this. And they thought this is so beautiful that there is no question of how does it form. It's obvious, right? It's some spontaneous association. So I used to argue with Clouel because I always often lost, right? So we phage people, we all knew that phages did not have icosahedral symmetry. They had this one vertex, which is absolutely special. And if you didn't have that vertex, you didn't have a phage, right? Where the tail attachment was, where DNA packaging occurred, et cetera. So I was intent on figuring out how these things got built. And at MIT, we had this very strong phage group, Ethan Signa, David Botstein, then Maury Fox was there, and Salvador Luria was in the background. So there was a very strong phage group. And David Botstein had done with P22 what Epstein and Edgar had done with T4 and isolated lots and lots of mutants. And P22 turned out to be wonderful. It infected Salmonella. The cell filled up with lots of virions. There was no proteolytic cleavage, so the polypeptides were the same coming off the ribosome all the way to the virus. There was high yields, lysed the cell. By that time, I was beginning to recruit a research group, many talented people, way too many to go over here. But in terms of this work on shell assembly, I just want to call attention to Martin Minks Fuller, one of my first graduate students, now professor at Stanford Medical School, and Peter Privilege, now at University of Alabama, and Bill Earnshaw at the University of Edinburgh, who made particularly productive institutions. Now, Cammy had joined the lab at that time. One of the things I learned from Edgar, so he had a research technician, Ilgali Lausis. There were a whole group of us graduate students, but all the productivity came from Edgar and Lee Lausis working together. And she knew how to get everything done. And I learned from that experience, that's key. You gotta have somebody who knows how to run a laboratory and how to grow the bacteria and what's happening down in the kitchen where they're sterilizing stuff. I was lucky enough at some point to have Cammy join the lab, and everything that follows, she's kind of underlying it, shoring up all the graduate students and the postdocs and the undergraduates and everybody else. In particular, my first postdoctoral fellow was Sherwood Kasdjians. He had been at Stanford with Dale Kaiser studying lambda assembly. And early on, we discovered, and with David Botstein, that it wasn't like the people said in the MRC. What happened was that inside the cell, a shell was built that didn't have DNA in it. It was empty of DNA. And then the DNA got pumped or packed into it. Now, at that time, that was considered totally absurd. The model was histones. Histones bind to DNA and condense DNA. The notion that you build a shell and then you thread the DNA into it, but that's what happens. Now, these shells aren't empty. It turns out they have something in them, and they have hundreds of molecules of a protein, which we call the scaffolding protein from my years of standing watching construction sites. So here are the proteins in the mature virion. There's obviously the capsid protein that's in hundreds of copies. But the precursor shell has the capsid protein, but has another protein, the scaffolding protein, that's gone in the mature virus. And Sherwood and I, to our surprise, were able to show that these scaffolding proteins were needed for the polymerization of the coat into this precursor shell. Then by some mysterious mechanism, they left the shell. The DNA was pumped in through this special vertex, the portal vertex, and then you went on to build a mature virus. And in P22, these molecules take part in about half a dozen rounds of particle assembly. So though they're a major protein in the precursor shell, they're a minor protein in an infected cell. And in many other systems, they were missed because not in the virus, minor proteins in the infected cell, you miss it. Now also key is what happens here, and this turns out to be a special, this vertex is occupied by this portal 12-fold. This is 12 molecules polymerized together. And this channel is the channel through which DNA goes into when the virus's DNA is being pumped in, and out of which the DNA comes on infection going the other way. And probably the evolution of double-stranded DNA viruses in general depended on the evolution of this device. Now, we were frustrated that this is the era, the first X-ray diffraction of plant viruses and the immense growth of structural biology. We didn't have X-ray structures. Phages in general, people had not been able to crystallize them. So we couldn't explain how come you have these hundreds of molecules of scaffolding and then you don't have them, right? It just didn't all fit together. But about that time, we started a collaboration with Wat Chu at the Baylor College of Medicine. He was just the starting assistant professor, and he was working on this technique of cryo-electron microscopy, which the crystallographers, we were excited to get 30 angstrom resolution, right? The X-ray crystallographers are going for 1 angstrom resolution. However, he worked, and this has been we've had now an ongoing productive collaboration for 30 years. But he was able to get a cryo-EM structure of the precursor shell. And lo and behold, there's a 6-fold vertex, there's a 5-fold vertex, there's a channel. And the channel turns out to be how the scaffolding gets out. And in the mature virus, the whole thing kind of slightly shifts. Each of these rings of subunits rotates and the channel closes. So in the mature virus, there are no holes. Things smooth as silk and absolutely resistant to external agents. So that was very useful. It's continued to be useful. Now, Hua and his team have kind of been the world leaders in advancing cryo-electron microscopy. They now compete with the X-ray diffraction people down to 3 angstroms with cryo-electron microscopy. And all of those technological advances depended on very high quality samples, phage samples, that CAMI, working together with other people in the lab, produced and sent on to Wat Chu. Here's the first time that they were able to get kind of atomic level resolution. This is epsilon 15 prepared together with Peter Weigel. So that's been very productive. Now, Tom mentioned the cyanophage. This happened later, but I'm going to move it a little earlier. So I was always interested in marine biology, and I was one of the few people in the department that had formal classical training in evolutionary biology and ecology. So at some point, I got appointed to the MIT Woods Hole Joint Program in Oceanography. I followed you, right? You had been on it for 10 years, right? So I used to have to go down to Woods Hole a few times a year to sit on thesis committees or discuss things. And I got to know John Waterbury, microbial physiologist, who really was the person who recognized that the ocean, this bacteria, Cynococcus, of photosynthetic cyanobacteria, was all through the world's oceans. And then later, Penny Chisholm recognized the second most important one, Prochlorococcus. Well, John Waterbury had isolated phages to these open ocean bacteria, and he had an electron microscope, and he had looked at them. And these phages looked just like T4 and lambda and P22. And I was astonished. It never would occur to me in a million years that in the ocean, infecting photosynthetic bacteria that evolved hundreds of millions of years before in terrestrial organisms, that the phages would look like T4 and P22 and lambda. So we began. So there's Cynococcus. Now, Cynococcus is photosynthetic. And what we really wanted to do is get access to the folding and assembly of the photosystem. And we thought, well, in phage-infected cells, we'd have get a kind of backdoor into photosynthesis. That didn't quite work, but we did get into phage assembly. And where's Desi? Oh, okay, so we had a group of collaborators. Jacqueline Perret is professor of microbiology at Northeastern, and who knows the difference between cyanobacteria and enteric bacteria. And then Desi Raycheva, who was a graduate student at Northeastern, we were able to do to have her work here on our system. By then, we also had Cindy Woolley as an administrative assistant. And so, all the money was being taken care of. And when we came in with our renewals and budgets and reports, we were just clean as a whistle with respect to that that world. With Peter Weigler, Peter Weigler, remember Sherwood Cashin is my first postdoc. He's a graduate student with Dale Kaiser at Stanford, comes to MIT. Then he goes to Utah. Peter Weigler was his graduate student and came here, so it was kind of my scientific grandson, right? It's kind of cool. And he found conditions where these open ocean bacteria, which are notoriously very finicky, would thrive in the lab, and the phages of them would actually lyse the culture in the lab. There was just no doubt about what was going on. You could just stand there and watch, and after a few hours, these highly pigmented cultures were cleared. And that allowed Jacqueline and Desi and Cammie and Peter to kind of do the molecular and structural biology of, and this, we ended up focusing on SIN5. SIN5 is a little tail like P22, but it has a horn, which was very intriguing. Still don't know what the horn does, but definitely has a horn. And then it turned out that the genes for the coat and scaffolding and portal and SIN5 were organized just like they were in T4, P22, lambda, T7. And lo and behold, it turned out that SIN5, infecting this photosynthetic bacteria in the open ocean, assembled itself just like all the other phages, just like adenovirus, just like herpes virus. You start with this portal, and then you have a coat and scaffolding, and you make a precursor shell. You have to get rid of the scaffolding, and the DNA gets pumped in. This is all the phages. Adenovirus and herpes virus are just like that. They're like animal phages. And what it looks like is, way back, long before there were enteric bacteria, this mechanism developed of portal coat scaffolding, making a precursor shell that then encompassed DNA. And all subsequent DNA viruses, whether animal, plant, et cetera, double-stranded DNA viruses, then use this initial mechanism. Some of you can say, well, it might have been, you know, independent convergent evolution, but it turns out that the conformation of all the coat proteins of all these viruses is almost the same, even though the sequences are totally different. And it actually does look much more like there was an original event and then diversification. Now, we had all these mutants affecting these structural proteins. And we wanted to find mutants that specifically affected the protein-protein interactions. And every time we carefully analyzed the effect of these mutations on the proteins we're studying, what it looked like was not that they didn't affect the assembly, they affected the folding of it. And that we had protein folding mutants, even though that wasn't what we were looking for. Anyway, at that time we had decided in terms of the search for mutants affecting protein-protein interactions that we would focus on the attachment protein of P22, the tail spike of P22, which uses its lateral surface to bind lipopolysaccharide projecting off the surface of PA2. Very complicated protein, trimeric. I'm not even going to try to show you what goes on here. The chains are actually wrapped around each other, intimately interdigitated. But one thing is clear. There's no way that this conformation could be present in the monomeric precursor. It had to be that the chain came off the ribosome in some other conformation, and then only after the interaction did you get the native conformation. Pretty soon we realized that we were studying the folding of this protein and not the assembly of the protein. All my biophysical colleagues thought it was totally insane to try, because at that time you found the smallest protein that you could find that folded up in seconds, and that's what you focused on. And these were big and complex. But those of us, you know, I was teaching about tubulin and myosin and collagen, knew that, hey, a lot of the organisms, important proteins in organisms are very big. They're very big and complex, and they have to fold up too. And, you know, so we'll tackle that. Now, I just want to go back. So the question then was, we know that the fold is encoded in the amino acid sequence, but it's the organization of the residues that determine the folding is very complex. We know there's lots of places in the chain where you can have mutations. It doesn't mess up the folding. It's probably some special clusters of subunits, of side chains that drive the fold, and we wanted to use mutants to try to identify those residues that were important for folding. Now, the longest part of the tail spike has a fold called the beta helix, which is the simplest beta sheet fold. And the beta helix fold is the same conformation as amyloid fibers. So I was already teaching protein folding in human disease. I knew about amyloid fibers, and I knew about the importance of this fold. And all these things together then served to recruit a second group of very talented students and postdocs. And I'm just going to talk in particular. Key was David Goldenberg, who really got the tail spike folding system going. And then Margaret Ryan Simkowski. You'll see in a second that we learned a lot about protein aggregation. And those students then became very appealing to the biotechnology industry. And a group of them went into the biotechnology industry. And that's where they still are. So one of the things we were able to do is to directly visualize partially folded intermediates and fractionate them on native gel electrophoresis. So this is an in vitro refolding. There you see is the native trimer. This is partially folded monomers. These are partially folded dimers. This is what's called the protrimer. The three chains are associated, but they're not locked in, they're not tight, and so they go slower in the gel, and then in a zero order reaction that matures to the tail spike. So this was, it was enormously useful since we had mutants that blocked these steps. To this day, biophysicists deny that this possibly could be the case because they have this notion of things that only have half-lives of seconds. But this protein inside the cell under optimal conditions, and there's no covalent modification, T1/2 of 5 minutes at 37 degrees. It takes a long time for this polypeptide chain to find the native fold. And before I end, I'm going to talk to you about the lens crystallins, smaller protein, but same thing. This protein doesn't find its native state like that. It takes it quite a while. So real proteins often takes a long time, and if you have one that's slow enough, you can actually trap the intermediates. In fact, there's a transient disulfide bond. That's why there's two species. One has it, one doesn't. One has it, one doesn't. But there's no disulfides in the native protein. These are just kinetic helps. Anyway, with all this talent, we were able to find out a lot about the pathway. Chains come off the ribosome. They form a partially folded monomeric species. These guys recognize. They recognize each other and form this protrimer, and then that matures to the native trimer. But if the temperature is a little too high, 1 or 2 degrees, or if the cells have these infected with these, what I'll show you, temperature-sensitive folding mutants, the chains don't get through this stage. They go off pathway and form this inclusion body. Now, this was a strange state of the protein. It was tend to be ignored by everybody. But this was the period of the rise of the biotech industry. This was when Walter Gilbert made the first public statement in the Wall Street Journal that his new company, Genentech, was making human insulin and human growth hormone. Unfortunately, he hadn't talked to the chemical engineers in the production plant who would have told him that no, they didn't have any active insulin and they didn't have any growth hormone. They had some strange precipitated state that wasn't soluble, and they couldn't figure out. What's that?
Somebody's phone.
Oh, it's my phone. Well, Well, I thought I turned it off. They couldn't figure out what was going on. They thought it was some ammonium sulfate or solubility problem. But you know, the biotech industry, they had a lot of influence, and they understood, well, we need to find out more about this, and they put some pressure back on the NIH and NSF. And by the way, it was Cammie who, it was Cammie's work who showed that this state derived not from the native state, like all the engineers thought, but from some early intermediate that was off pathway. So we had an experimental system where you could study inclusion body formation. We were able to continue to do the research. We couldn't always get it published. You know, we'd get rejected from biochemistry. The aggregation, that's not a, it's not a legitimate biochemical, you know, subject. But we placed a couple of articles in the new biotechnology literature that was read by the people in the biotechnology industry, and that spread. To this day, you know, this is a constant problem. You try to express some eukaryotic protein in bacteria, you get an inclusion body. It's not clear. Often it's very difficult to solve. Difficult to solve that problem. This was sometimes funny because at that time I was a kind of vocal critic of the privatization I thought Genentech had just ripped off the public. They had taken these strains that had been NIH funded, moved it to a warehouse in South San Francisco, and then applied for patents on it as if it was they had invented it. So I was persona non grata in the management, but the production people, they wanted to talk to somebody who could help them, so things moved forward. I'm going to run out of time, so I'm going to, well, okay, so let me just say that these mutants that we were studying, temperature-sensitive folding mutants, it turned out that what they did was they identified residues that were important in the intermediate, but you didn't need it in the native state. It stabilized the folding intermediates to high temperature, but had no effect on the native state. And these all turned out to be on the surface of the protein. These are the gray are the buried core residues. All of the TS mutants were at kind of surface loops and turns, and probably important kinetically for getting the chain into the right conformation. But the mutant chains folded up at low temperature, so it couldn't be that these were the key residues controlling the beta helix fold, because it folded up at low temperature and they were biologically active, thermostable. Well, the key breakthrough was made by Ryan Simkowski, who realized this is the side chains, the polypeptide backbone is going like this, and these are the side chain pointing in from the backbone at different rungs. And you see they form these beautiful stacks, there are 13 rungs going like this, but the side chains all are stacked from top to bottom. And Ryan thought maybe it's the stacking of these internal residues that are controlling the fold. And he generated mutants of every single residue in the buried core of the tail spike. And blue means that if you put an alanine there in place of a valine or a phenylalanine or a leucine, you block the folding of the chain. One amino acid substitution in 666 residues blocks the folding. And it turns out the only way to understand that but is that if the folding is precessive, you get started, and then the next rung is formed by the stacking of the internal hydrophobics on the rung below, and then only if that rung is formed can you form the next rung. It's kind of like the sheath assembly thing. It's right, you have to get one stage, and then the next one, and then the next one, next one. And this is probably how amyloid fibers form also, but with separate chains. Anyway, by this time, we had a lot of experience with aggregated proteins. And I thought, well, it's time. I'm getting on in years. It's time to tackle one of these diseases of gray-haired people that are associated with things like amyloid fibers. And George Benedek was a physicist who had been studying lens proteins in cataract, and he approached us about getting help with electron microscopy. And cataract had the feature that it's due to the lens has to be transparent, it's full of these proteins, the crystallines. If the crystallines aggregate, you get light scattering, and that's the pathology. So in cataract, it was very clear that the aggregation is the source of the pathology. That was less clear with Parkinson's, Alzheimer's, et cetera. Then a group of human geneticists discovered that families that carried a single amino acid substitution in human gamma D, the monomeric crystalline. So that's gamma D crystalline, beautiful Greek, double Greek key protein, 170 or so amino acids. Nothing there but protein. That families with a single amino acid substitution in the gene for human gamma D, the children often had congenital cataracts. Clear, that's the protein to study. Right, single amino acid substitution, get cataracts. It turns out it had these four buried tryptophanes. They have some very, very unusual fluorescence properties, very highly quenched when it's folded. But it turned out that these were exquisitely useful reporters for whether the protein was folded or not folded. And then this project, with its direct medical application, attracted another group of very talented people. The ringleader was Melissa Kaczynski-Collins. Melissa joined the group, and then she recruited from subsequent years' classes many other talented students, Shannon Flaw and Kate Moreau, Shara Mills, and Fanron Kong, and Zhejin Shen. And most recently, he just defended this is 2 weeks ago, a brilliant defense. I wish there was more distance between his talk and mine, because he did a beautiful job, who was kind of wrapping up these studies. So we were able to find conditions where this protein refolded in the test tube without any help, and it turned out that it went through a very distinctive partially folded intermediate that could be characterized. And many years of work and many theses were able to go a long way to defining how it folded up, which is that first form the C-terminal Greek key and it nucleates. It's one conformation nucleating the next one until you get the native state. But the unfolding pathway is not that different from the folding pathway, except there's this off-pathway aggregated state. So this is what causes the light scattering in the cataract. This was much, much, much tougher to sort out. And Eugene, in his thesis, finally shone some light, the first elucidation of what's going on, and was able to show that there's a very, very distinctive conformation that has a non-native disulfide bond that kind of stabilizes a strange conformation that's needed for domain swamping polymerization, and almost certainly opens up that whole area to research. Now, I'm running out of time, so I'm going to skip the last project in the lab, which was the human. The access to the crystallines gave us a substrate. This was done with human crystalline, gave us a substrate for human chaperones. And we joined an effort to tackle the major intracellular eukaryotic chaperoning TC, which we call TRIC, which is needed to fold tubulin and actin. This was the work of, some of you may know Oksana, she was here not so many years ago, and Kelly Nee, who's now across the street at Pfizer. And Ligia, who studied the ILENS chaperone, alpha crystalline. So obviously all these years I'm teaching, right? I don't have time to go into that. I do want to say that for years when we taught biomedical electron microscopy, we saved many undergraduates from cracking up. You know, they were getting C averages, they were going to flunk out, and they learned this skill. That was this very distinctive skill, and they knew they could get employed at it, and it kind of stabilized. Yeah, this is very, very useful. With Janice Chang, we introduced zebrafish as the developmental experiment in 702. It was a brilliant, brilliant module. The students could actually watch these transparent eggs transforming into a little baby fish. Nothing quite like it, but it was very expensive to maintain the fish, and we fell victim to budget things, as did the microscopy lab, which we no longer teach, too expensive to teach. Now, I want to close with, you know, I was of the generation, my scientific images, Barry Commoner, Linus Pauling, George Wald. When I came to Caltech, Linus Pauling had just been given the Nobel Prize for his work stopping atmospheric testing. Right. George Wald, who had gotten the Nobel Prize for the identification of the opsins, was a leader of the anti-war movement. So there was never a time in my life that it ever occurred to me that there was any separation between being a working scientist and these larger social issues. All the people I admired most did both. There were things going on that influenced that environment. My wife had been the press secretary of Mel King, the first black to run for mayor in Boston, and then later for Jesse Jackson in the presidential campaign. If Jesse Jackson had gotten the nomination, I would have been the director of the National Science Foundation. and so we had this circle of, you know, Tom's talking about powerless connections with a group of people who were leading a very different life than our faculty was. I had very valuable connection with the labor movement through Tony Mizaki of the Oil, Chemical, and Atomic Workers. I actually knew about occupational health and safety issues. I wasn't just spouting. And then our kids who were in the Cambridge public schools. Cambridge public schools are extremely diverse, right? Haitian bilingual program, and you're playing soccer with all these people. And so we had a circle much more diverse, for example, than where I grew up. I mean, I grew up in a mixed community, but there were, for example, lots of Puerto Ricans, but my family never, we didn't have any Puerto Rican friends. Right? They were African Americans, we didn't have any African Americans. I'd never been inside a Protestant church, never been inside a Catholic church. You know, it was, you couldn't see the segregation, but it was complete in terms of the social segregation. So these things were very important. And that led to many, you know, social issues, all of which really had the character of democratic oversight of science and technology. Some are in sociology textbooks, like the XYY affair. Me and Wald and Ruth, we were all excoriated for calling for regulation of recombinant DNA technology. Years later, the biotechnology industry say, thank God that they set up a system of regulation that allowed us to thrive without worrying about what was going to happen. And various others. Very important as a biologist was the work on the Biological Weapons Convention. I'll just say, when Reagan came to office, he remilitarized the economy and reopened biological weapons research, even though Nixon had helped pass the Biological Weapons Convention, which all nations of the world, almost all, had signed, except the US. So a group of us organized a campaign called the Pledge Against the Military Use of Biological Research. We got these signatures by circulating the petitions at scientific seminars, right? We didn't segregate it. Went to Cold Spring Harbor, gave our phage talk, and then circulated the petition. You can't do it nowadays. That would, I mean, it doesn't happen, right? So they were gonna, what the Army was gonna do is reopen the Doug Ware Biological and Chemical Warfare Facility in Utah. Well, Utah microbiologists, including Sherwood, who at that time was at University of Utah, organized against it. I had the thrilling opportunity of meeting with the elders of the Mormon Church to talk about the fact that it's not really a good idea to reopen this Doug Ware facility. This was one of the more successful campaigns. At some point, we actually were able to get Senate hearings before the right committee, the Senate ratified the Biological Weapons Convention, and many of us thought, thank goodness that genie is not at it, is back in the box. We don't have to worry about it. Unfortunately, after 9/11, the situation changed, and now it's worse than it was then. Let me close with what am I going away into the sunset on? I always knew how important it was that there was public funding for biomedical research, right? I knew that the National Institutes of Health was paid for by taxpayers and the National Science Foundation, and I was a kind of public servant, and thank goodness for that. So here's last year's congressional budget, and the blue is military spending. Here is all US biomedical R&D, basic science, and it's right, $30 billion. It's peanuts compared to the to that side of the thing. Well, the only way that you can spend $600 billion of taxpayers' money for weapons development is to cut every single sector of the economy, housing, healthcare, transportation. You know why the Green Line is no money for the Green Line? This is why there's no money for the Green Line, literally. So how do they do this? They keep you ignorant. Have you ever gotten a report from the federal government saying how your tax dollars were spent? No, you've never seen that. No agency of the government reports this data on how the money is actually spent. And if you meet with Mike Capuano, he'd say, oh, they're not related. Because the military budget is separate from the NIH budget. It's one budget, right? You spend less on one side, you have more on the other side. So unfortunately, one of the reasons this is going up is an insane, and I'm closing with this, an insane decision to upgrade the already obscene nuclear weapons forces, spend $1 trillion over the next 30 years upgrading all of the nuclear missiles on the submarines and the airplanes and in the silos. It is insane. And it's extremely dangerous, because if you're sitting in Russia or you're sitting in China and you see that the US is modernizing, increasing the accuracy of the weapons, you think, whoa, you know, what's that for? Well, we better do the same thing. Where does that come from? These weapons contracts are the only contracts in the United States where the profit margins are completely protected from everything. There's no outsourcing to the Chinese. They're cost plus, no matter how inefficiently they produce the missiles, they make it guaranteed. And there's no auditing because of secrecy. So you can't, even your congressman cannot look at these budgets for the nuclear weapons. They're completely protected. And if you ask, where did this program come from? Did the Navy call for it? No, the Navy's worried they're not going to have enough money for conventional ships. The Army called for it? Who called for it? The industry called for it, right? They're the leading lobbyists in the country. They have billions in contracts, and they recycle a subset of them back into lobbying, back into political campaigns, back into giving universities money to hire a research specialist in international security who claims, oh yeah, we really do have to worry about the Russians. You know, Ukraine is almost near Mexico, right? It's only 10,000 miles away, right? First they'll be in Ukraine, next they'll be in Canada border. So just 2 weeks ago, we actually revived the long tradition of MIT, having had a conference reducing the dangers of nuclear war. Mayor Simmons was there announcing the Cambridge City Council is gonna divest from pension fund for money in companies making nuclear weapons. There's me, there's Maria Zuber, Vice President of Research. It'll be an annual conference. I hope you'll be there. Some people from biology will be there next year. And we're hoping that Obama, who started in his office by saying you got to get rid of nuclear weapons, will, before he goes, decide, and he's the commander in chief, he has the authority to pull back on a lot of this stuff, that he will take some steps in that direction. So that's what I'll be working on, because if it all blows up, all the best research in the world on protein folding isn't going to get very, very, very far. So at that, thank you very much. Sorry for going over. Quote, now we can have a conversation, but we'd probably have to leave, right? or maybe we don't.
So you pointed to the half of the budget that's directly to military spending, but if you actually break down the basic science budget, like NSF, NIH, all that, the number one recipient of funding is, I think, it's either Lockheed Martin or BAE.
Lockheed, on the military side, right, Lockheed is the number one.
Is that just like kind of a lower priority, or like what do you do to even address those sort of issues? That a lot of that basic science funding is again going to defense contractors.
It's not, well, no, that sliver up there, the $30 billion, that's the civilian R&D.
So that took out like Lockheed Martin.
Yeah, and the way the Congress does it, all of the military side is done by its own appropriations. You never have a committee that's looking at civilian and military together. Well, except for the Department of Energy. Because most people think the Department of Energy is about energy, right, like solar energy. And most people don't know the Department of Energy has the portfolio for the actual warheads. And so a lot of the nuclear weapons, a lot of the DOE budget is nuclear weapons. When the Department of Energy also runs the big facilities like the synchrotrons. And some of the best X-ray sources and light sources are from the DOE facilities. So when I was the Biophysical Society president, I thought, well, what I'll try to do is get a little more time at those facilities, because people were having to queue and they were enormously valuable. And it was nickels and dimes compared to the DOE budget. So we thought, well, we'll just lobby the DOE to get a little more money for this stuff. It's so valuable, cancer research, Alzheimer's. Well, no, man, that DOE budget is, completely non-transparent. You know, it's kind of a jobs program in New Mexico and Brookhaven, South Carolina. They don't identify the biomedical research as a line item. You can't even start the lobbying on it because all of the facilities have this. They also do, in that case, they often do secret work, and so it was very frustrating. The NIH has pushed for this. They've pushed to get more and more time, but they're actually constrained by that same pie chart.
John, you mentioned, sorry, yeah.
No, I was just going to ask about the NIH budget. I remember we had doubled during times of Clinton, and
right.
What is going on now?
So, there was this wonderful full period. I was actually on the National the FASEB committee that was organizing that lobbying, which we had to be very careful, because if you're receiving money, you're not supposed to be lobbying on it. And we organized biomedical scientists around the country. We identified all the people on the appropriations committee for the NIH, organized groups of scientists, not to go to Washington, but in the district that the congressman had to get elected, right, meeting with them. And we were able to get this doubling. Now, if you look at the cost of Alzheimer's disease, it is enormous, enormous burden on the society, right? Because the people still have to be taken care of. Alzheimer's, we know a lot about the basic biology. It's one of those things that we're going to be able to find Alzheimer's therapies, but it's very expensive because the clinical studies have to be with humans. They have to be on things of learning that are not that easy. That budget for Alzheimer's research, it shouldn't go from, $500 million to $1 billion. It should go to $10 billion or something like that, given how expensive Alzheimer's Society. But the NIH budget, as everybody here knows, it's been very, very stable. People within the business of lobbying for it say blah 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 blah. I say you can't beat Lockheed Martin, right? They're going to make sure that $600 billion is in the budget, right? And that creates a situation where your congressman can absolutely tell you, I'd love to increase the NIH budget, but it's not possible. I actually was in a meeting with Capuano, that's our congressman, 3 months ago. And he says, oh, you got to be realistic, you got to be practical, you can't have pie in the sky, there's no money there, right? There's no money there, Right, no money there. Just $1.5 trillion. No, no money there. Now you try to raise with him, well, what about the other side of the budget? He just stops that discussion dead. You know, Raytheon is in Waltham. Raytheon is watching the political environment with a very, very sharp eye. The moment a sitting congressman starts talking about peace, Raytheon starts sending the letters. You know, they have their blue-collar workforce, their IBEW members, their staff. They start giving money to opposition candidates. So if you're a politician, you know, you have to be very careful. And the defense industry is brilliant about that. And then if worse to worse, they'll try to scare you, saying, we have to do that. I know Alzheimer's is important, but national security trumps that. In the first version of my talk, I started off by saying, you know, when I first became a scientist, the NIH budget was going like that. We never had to worry. That was just what you worked at it, but you didn't worry about it. It's very, very different now. You know, I often feel for the young scientists who have to go out into this world that's much, 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 much more difficult. But it shouldn't be. That budget still should be going up, should be doubling again.
John, I have a comment and a question. You mentioned Linus Pauling and his leftist views. I remember when I was a student in England, I think this was about the time when it must be when he got the Nobel Peace Prize. There was a meeting, this Chemical Society meeting, he was supposed to be there, and he was not allowed to be there. This was in the 50s, in some 58, something like that. When did he get the prize?
Early 60s, I think.
He got the prize for chemistry.
No, he got the Nobel Prize for chemistry. That I didn't have any problem with that. It was the second campaign that caused the problem. It must have been in the 60s. I think it was when I was at Caltech, because I remember that the chemistry department, it was a kind of local scandal, the chemistry department declined to give him a party for the second Nobel Prize. By the way, he wasn't...
64 won the Peace Prize.
Oh, 64, okay, right. By the way, he was not a leftist, believe me, right? He was a geologist. That's what he was, and a brilliant biochemist. He wasn't political, in the
days of the MacArthur era.
That's right. Yeah. That's right. So opposing testing was like being for the Soviet Union, right? So everybody doing that got brushed.
The question I have for you, John, is the following: have you ever written a perspective or something like that for any journal that describes this whole thing that you talked about? How you got from one thing to another.
Yeah, so,
of your scientific.
So one of my own failings, you know, I'm very much an experimental biologist and always nervous about these, often fighting against theories that, you know. And so over the years, I on numerous occasions failed to draw the lesson that most people were interested in, right, which you had to do, right, and cast the result, the finding, in a way that was generally accessible. The phage systems are very complex experimental systems in a certain sense. Not easy for people to keep track of it. And so this was a kind of general, you know, I keep on thinking, well, that's what I should do now. I should write up all these, you know, more broader perspectives.
To the outside reader, you know.
The one place where we did do that was around inclusion body formation, where we did write these articles that, like I said, were read by people in the biotechnology industry that said this has to do with protein misfolding and not about properties in the native state. It's a worthwhile goal.